Blog Talk Radio.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Goddess Suite. Holistic Gals here. Who else is on the line?
This is Mystic Feather. Good evening, everybody. Hope everybody's doing well out there.
Welcome. It is Sister Love, the one and only, on the show.
Hi, goddesses. How are you all tonight?
We are great tonight. So this rain, we've had rain all day today, and it was a little sleet when I went out lunchtime. So I came home and took me a miniature nap to get ready and just energized for the show tonight. We have a great, great guest, Mr. Professor James Small.
Oh, wow. We are blessed tonight. We are blessed tonight.
Absolutely.
Yes, we are. Well, we'll get started. We're going to dedicate the song for tonight for Professor James Small, The Commodores, High on Sunshine. And we'll be back.
All right.
Give me room to see where I'm going.
Welcome back to the Goddess Suite.
Welcome, welcome, welcome. How's everybody tonight out there listening?
Hopefully all is well.
Well, let's get into it.
Yes, we have to be high on sunshine, just like the Commodore said.
Yes. And I can't wait for tonight's show to begin. Professor Small is going to be talking about something that we all love to talk about on the Goddess Feet, and that's spirituality. Is he on the line now?
I don't see his number yet, so we can just
talk
a bit about him.
Oh, okay. All right. Well, tonight's topic is going to be called the God Essence. So we will be talking about spirit, and which is one of our favorite topics on the Goddess Suite. What is the God Essence to you all? What does it mean to you all?
The God essence is what is within. It is the essence of God that lives within all of us. Because as Professor Small says, we're all portions of God living a human experience.
Yes, I definitely agree with that. Definitely agree. And if you all haven't checked out Dr. Small, if you're not knowledgeable about him, you should get knowledgeable about him. This brother made a lot of contributions to our community on the whole, and he is definitely one of the pioneers and trailblazers of the conscious community, or the awareness community, as we like to say. He has numerous videos on YouTube. He's on Facebook, so you want to check him out definitely to get more enlightened and get you more knowledge on these type of subjects dealing with spirituality and also our history. He is very well versed on our history as black race. So please become familiar with him and just, you know, as well as all of the other great pioneers that help bring this knowledge into existence for us, because this is what's helping us move and elevate on our spiritual path. So it's very important that you are aware of the elders and the ones that have laid the path for us.
That's right. And if you want to read a little more about Professor James Small, his website is www.profjamessmalafricanworld.com. So it's Prof James Small African World.com. And he is he's going to be in Washington, D.C. this weekend, Saturday, December 13th, from 2 p.m. to 6 p.m. It was going to be at the African American Civil War Museum. And the address is 1925 Vermont Avenue, Northwest, Washington, D.C., 200001. And lecture will begin promptly at 3 p.m. And he's going to be talking about the God essence, awaken, being able to awaken and discover your own divine self. So we are most definitely excited about this lecture this weekend. What a treat here in the nation's capital.
Yes, this is definitely a treat, you know, for our people to come out of this slumber that we're in, and we know that, you know, everybody is at their divine place, at the divine time, and they awaken that way. But, you know, it's just wonderful to see that, you know, we have different avenues and resources to go to, you know, develop further spiritually, because that's the main reason that we're here. So as we learn, we can help other people learn, and the process never ends. So
absolutely.
We just feel honored, you know, that
yes,
Dr. Smalls is going to be on tonight.
He is. And without further ado, Professor James Small, hello and welcome to the Goddess Suite.
Hello, Hotep. Peace and love to you, sisters. Thank you for having me on.
Thank you for being on. Thank you. We're honored. Thank you so much.
Mm-hmm. Yes, thank you for coming on.
Well, you guys are the one that's teaching the world. I'm just stopping by to do a say hello kind of thing as you're doing your work. That's real. That's what it really is.
We love it, Dr. Smalls. Well, you can start off tonight by starting and talking about what the God essence is. Because, you know, a lot of us are just waking up. A lot of people are still, you know, on the fence with Christianity and other religions and things like that. So if you can just go into what the God essence means, and then from there you can talk about whatever you would like to talk about.
Well, we're going to work together on the talk about stuff.
Oh, yeah, we got questions. We got questions.
Okay. But I was talking to one of my sisters today out in San Diego, and she was telling me a story, not really a story. She was telling me about an occasion when one of her children, I think her 11-year-old, asked, they had taught their children that, you know, God is within us. They had taught their children that this, the image or the character that's called Jesus Christ was an African. So I think the child asked, do white people worship Jesus Christ? And she said, yes. And the little boy asked, why, you know?
wow.
And she explained to him that, you know, there's some people in the world who have been taught that God is outside of you, and that God is way off in space someplace, and you have to, you know, do certain rituals and ceremonies to try and appeal to that God, and that God would then interfere in your life to help you or whatever, and that same God created a devil who lives down here with you, you know, who's making life miserable for you, and you have to then try to find this external force and make an appeal for it to help you with the condition that it created for you. And the child didn't think it makes much sense. I may not be saying it exactly like she told me, but it's close. And she was saying, well, this is what is taught to our people, and this is what we have to try and change, this external remove God. And then the son asked the people, white people worship the black Jesus, and she said, no. And he says, why not? And so she went online and showed him the white Jesus, and the child took it aback, like, oh, no, that can't be true. Like, you know, how could this be kind of thing? Like, so here was a child raised and being raised as an African child in an African household to perceive the divine in the way our ancestors perceived it. But we live in a culture where the whole concept of God is just the opposite. We live in a Euro-American culture in terms of the spiritual and religious dominant ideas, and that teaches us that God is without us, is up there someplace, and you have to appeal to it through rituals and prayers and things, and it might help you if you're a good guy. And the African tradition is just the opposite. In all African languages that I've studied, God is referred to as the totality of creation, the totality of what we call creation, including us, meaning that God is not God of the tree. The tree is an aspect of God. God is not God of me and you. We are aspects of God. And so that the African culture teaches us that all that is that exists makes up the totality of the divine, and that we are just an expression of an aspect of that divine existence having the human experience. And in all of our traditions, we leave that conscious attachment to divinity and come into this expression of its aspect called the human being with a clear destiny, with a clear path on what we are to do. And a big part of what we are to do is to perfect ourselves. It's kind of like a boomerang. Imagine we are cells in God's body, and God's throw it out like a boomerang. No matter how far away it goes, eventually, after having all of those varied experiences of flying around and about, it returns to the source of its genesis. And that's about as clear a take I can give you on African theology. And people like to say African theology, African is different. No, there's not multiple. There may be multiple expressions of African theology, but there's only one theology. It is the same whether you're in South Africa, East Africa, Central Africa, West Africa, or North Africa, except where outside religious philosophy and theologies like Judaism, Christianity, and Islam has come in. And so when we, those of us in this country who came over here as prisoners of war, they like to call us slaves, but none of our people signed a contract to be a slave to anybody. So we were captured, enslaved, so we were fundamentally prisoners of war. Somebody fights to capture you and take away your freedom, and you're resisting that because I don't think our people went along with it. So this sounds good. Where are we going? New York? Okay, I'm down with that. No, we were prisoners of war that was treated and violated in every anti-human way possible, and yet we sustain our African humanity to this day. And we have sustained within our subconscious, if not always in our conscious, our African notion of divinity. So there's one thing I like to tell people about looking at the divine. And so I always talk about the genes and the DNA of God. And so I would say our ancestors are our pedigree. And you learn your pedigree from studying your history. And when you do that, you learn that God is your original ancestry. So people define themselves by referring to their origin. And when you do that, you realize that we are the best of our ancestors' genes, which means God, because if God is the first and the only thing that exists, everything else that comes into existence must come into existence out of it.
Exactly.
Okay? So that makes God is our original ancestors. So we are the best of our ancestor God genes. We are the latest version of our ancestors' genes. We are the highest tech version of our ancestors' genes. And when we have our children, they're the best of our genes, the latest version, and the highest tech model. So each of us are God having a human experience or an expression of an aspect of God's divine essence having this human experience. So that's what I'm going to be talking about on Saturday, but I'm going to be breaking it down in pieces and looking at it, and I'm going to be doing a PowerPoint, so there'll be some pictorials and other stuff. But I'm going to try to show people that there is the essence of the divine. It is within each of us. And, you know, I was a Muslim imam for some 18 years. I went to Mecca in 1974 and 1975, and there wasn't a whole bunch of African Americans going to Mecca in those days, you know. And there's a phrase in Islam that said, Allah is as close to you as your jugular vein. In short, it says, God is in you.
Right.
You know?
Wow.
And if you read through the Bible, you'll see the same thing all
over. Yeah, I was about to say, yeah.
Okay.
The same thing.
So and remember, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam is nothing more than fragments from the periphery of the African spiritual system. All of them had their birth in Africa, you know. And then we tend to, we talk about the Middle East and the Holy Land. We're talking about Northeast Africa. And even Moses and Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, all these guys, is hanging out in Egypt when they get their head together, okay?
Right.
And so when we get to Jesus, when Mary and Joseph, when they're trying to kill Jesus, where does God send him? To Egypt to get his stuff together.
Right.
Okay.
But Professor Smalls, I didn't mean to interrupt, but right there where you're talking about.
You can interrupt anytime you want.
Okay. We were talking about Jesus and Moses and the crew. Is it, okay, to clear up the confusion, because, you know, some people say that they are historically existed, and then some say that they're metaphors.
They're a little
bit
of both. They're both.
Okay.
In the Old Testament, you may be dealing with more ethno-history than metaphor, but you're dealing with metaphor and allegory too. And in Christianity, you're dealing with more metaphor and allegory. There is no historical documents past their spiritual books to validate any of it as being historically anything.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Okay.
So the only theocratic foundation that has a historical backing for it is the civilizations in Kemet and the rest of Africa. Because outside of our religion, the oldest religious text in the world that we know of, I'm sure there are things older, is the pyramid text. And in the pyramid text, you already have the Genesis story almost word for word that the Hebrews will copy. And then the Christians will copy, and the Muslim will copy. The same Genesis story. And the only changes you'll see is cultural.
Okay.
You know?
Right.
And I'll show you for an example. In the pyramid text, God, Amun, and the word Amun means that which is hidden. Okay. That which is unknown and unknowable, but we know it's there because it's manifest in other ways. And so Amun says, I created myself out of myself. I created myself out of myself. Now, you got to listen to this good because there's some heavy stuff in the few lines. This is in the pyramid text. I created myself out of myself. And when I realized myself to be, when I became conscious of me, this is what God's saying now. When I became conscious of me, the woman was standing beside me. He didn't make him from a rib. Okay, and this woman is called Ma'at, who God later in the theology would be referred to as the daughter of God. But he goes further. He says, I brought myself into being out of the primordial waters of Nun, who God, the ones that the Kemetian people call the Almighty, Amun, will later refer to as his mother. When he says, I came from my mother, Nun. So before Amun, the God of gods, existed, that out of which he came into being, Nun, existed. And so when he was saying, I created myself out of myself, he's saying, I created myself out of my mother.
Wow.
So who is divinity? Femininity.
Yeah.
That's right. So when you read the literature, and these books are thousands of years older than the Bible and the Torah and all of this stuff. And he goes further. When you read the document, it goes further. And I'm paraphrasing, you know, because this is a large book like all spiritual books. But I'm pretty much on point with my paraphrasing. Then he says, I created first Shu. And then I made a twin for him, Tefnut. Now, when you look and see who Shu is the god of air, they say when they, people look at it. He's the net of air. Shu is air.
Okay.
Tefnut is moisture. So, and he created Shu and Tefnut, but he realized he needed a place to stand, so a foundation. This is God now, so everything can be cool and he can do his work.
Right.
And so out of the same waters out of which the God said it came, rise what is called the primordial hill, which we call in Kemet, Ptah. So now you got solid matter coming out of liquid matter, and then you got God, the consciousness, which is dealing with both and producing air, and moisture. So now you got solid matter, air, and moisture, and they come together, and they produce nuts, the sky, the elements, and geb, the earth.
Wow.
And then all of these deities or forces of nature then produces Asar, Aset, Set, Nephthys, and Heru. And
mm-hmm.
out of them come the rest of mankind and womankind.
Okay.
That's our Genesis story. And in doing this, God says how he created things. He says, I did it by, and when he came to Shu and Tefnut, he said, I sort of like, you know how we clear our throat, and I spat. And he spat them out. But how he created the others, he said, I hicker. Hicker means to vibrate, or the word. So there it goes. In the beginning was the word, and the
was
word was God.
The word was in, oh, wow.
Now,
wow.
This is our literature. This thing, and I knew the Bible now. This is the pyramid text thousands of years before.
Okay.
And then God said the piece that I always found to be most profound, because it
mm-hmm.
leads into what we're talking about tonight and what we're going to be talking about on Saturday.
Okay.
When God says, and after I've created all that my heart desired, and I created you, I then expanded in you. And that shit right there is deep.
That is
I then
very deep.
Expanded in
yes.
you. And so that's why in African culture, we are but an expression of aspects of the divine essence having this human experience.
Wow.
And so when I talk about awakening the divine within, I'm talking about really getting back to your culture, back to African spirituality, not someone
mm-hmm.
else's innovation on it.
Okay.
You know, not a hologram of it, but
okay.
the real thing, you know.
Right. Now, Professor Small, this is interesting. We're talking about this tonight because I'd say like a week ago, I was doing some research, and there was this woman named Diane Cannon, I believe, and she pretty much explained everything the way you just did about how we came into being and we're expressions of God, and she said that we're expressions of God, so God is experiencing life through us, and so there's no good or bad because he's experiencing all the possibilities of life through all of us. And so she was like, and then
is that
it's
a
not
black
just
woman
happen-
or a white woman?
I
got to ask a question. Yeah, because
so
the way you just said it, that's the way white people approach our stuff when they get on to it.
Okay,
see,
and that's why I wanted to know, because I'm like,
right.
Okay.
Now, in the voodoo tradition, and this is voodoo, but they didn't call it voodoo back then, but this is what
okay.
we're calling voodoo today. And remember what I just said, African men and women wrote that.
Okay.
Not some
okay.
god popping out of nothing. This
okay.
is how our ancestors perceived their coming into being.
Okay.
As it was passed down to them by their ancestors, and as they had interpreted the millions and probably billions of years of their experience in existence
mm-hmm.
to that point.
Okay.
You understand?
Yes.
Y'all
yes.
with me?
Yes.
Okay.
Right. Yes.
Now let's come back to the lady Diane. See,
yes.
in voodoo, there's no right, there's no wrong, there's no good, there's no bad. But there's order.
Mm. Okay.
And what white
okay.
folks fail to deal with is the order. And that's what
okay.
the Africans in the Nile Valley call Ma'at.
Okay.
And that's what the Yoruba call the gentle character, Iwapile. And that's what the Igbo call Omanele, harmony and balance within and without. And
mm-hmm.
so that's when we started dealing with cause and effect.
Okay.
And that's when we start talking about what is called contraction and expansion
mm-hmm.
in nature.
Okay.
All of those things really represents the same phenomena, the phenomena of expansion and contraction. And the purpose
mm-hmm.
is to create the fiction that would produce the action to keep the balance. And that's what that scale of Ma'at is about. That if you lose the balance, then there is disorder.
Okay.
And so your efforts is to maintain the balance. And the way you maintain the balance is to strive for perfection, or strive to perfect the divine mm-hmm. within, and build a relationship with the divine without.
So, Professor Small, do you believe that the white race, do you believe that black souls can reincarnate through the white race, or is that a myth, or what's your take on that?
It would be wonderful if somebody could cite some historical example of that.
Right.
It's been around long enough. No.
Right.
I don't think the what we're calling white, meaning the genetic house
mm-hmm.
that we call Caucasian,
mm-hmm.
it doesn't have the capacity to hold or contain the spirit that comes out of the African.
Okay.
Okay. It does not have the capacity to contain it. You remember, well, you don't have to remember, and some people disagree with me on this one, but I contend, along with many of our great scientists and scholars and anthropologists and archaeologists, from Chekhunta Diop to Dr. Ben to Dr. Clark to many others,
mm-hmm.
that the white man is nothing more than a mutation off of the black gene pool, that black people are the parent people and the original manifestation of God as a human.
Okay.
Mm. You got
so
that?
Yes. So God, is he still manifesting through them on a different type of scale, or is the only thing
that exists, let's not get caught up in their theology. Forget that. It's hard to do. But if the only thing that exists is God, then everything in existence is an aspect of that existence.
Right. Okay.
White people represents a mutated extreme to the human existence of divinity.
And
that mutation is an extreme deficiency or deprivation.
Okay.
You understand?
Yeah, I'm trying to, because I hear so many different things.
It's a different way of putting it.
and
people say, well, is he being a racist? No, I'm not being a racist. Yep. White people, well, the people we call white, the people we call Caucasians,
uh-huh.
is a mutation
mm-hmm.
off of the blackest black.
Yeah.
Okay. It is a genetic mutation. And
yep.
it is the extreme. The blackest black is the original manifestation. The whitest white is an extreme mutated version of that original manifestation.
Mm-hmm.
In that mutation that had to occur because of adaptation in the
mm-hmm.
ice of Europe, it had to deprivate. It had to create deficiencies.
Mm.
And that deficiency doesn't give it the capacity to hold spiritual reality.
Okay.
Y'all got that?
Yeah. I got that, Professor Smalls, which leads me to my next question. Do you believe that we are suffering, or something happened that our race is suffering and we're under the captivity
of...
No,
I'll tell you right now, no. The only thing that's going on is our ignorance. Mm.
Okay.
Ignorance is the only thing that have us suffering.
Okay.
Do you know your mama's story? Do you know your daddy's story? If you don't know your mama's story and daddy's story, you don't know your story.
Right.
And if you don't know your story, how can you even tell a story? I mean, telling a story is living your life in an appropriate manner. So you got to know your mama and daddy's story, meaning you got to know the history of your ancestors.
Mm.
And 99% of us don't. There's a few 5 to 10% that got some fragments.
Right.
But we don't know our lineage. That's why I said what I said before when I said our ancestry
mm-hmm.
or our pedigree. You learn your pedigree from your history.
Mm.
people define themselves by referring to their origin.
Mm.
You know?
Yeah, so what is this about the Caucasian people being created in a laboratory or something like that? Have you heard of something?
You know, when you talk the theology of the lost found nation of Islam in the West, as articulated by the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, do talk about a mad scientist but named Yaqub, who created the white man. But that's a metaphor.
Okay.
Yeah, that's a metaphor. And we don't understand. We seem to think that the only people that could create an explanation for life is white folks. Okay?
Yes.
The Honorable Elijah Muhammad was on point. He was trying to explain to Africans who had been enslaved and imprisoned in the United States for nearly 300 years how to realize and understand the reality they found themselves in and how to recognize the elements therein. And so he created metaphor and allegory to explain it, just like everybody do when they're trying to come up with a spiritual way to free yourself from bondage, psycho-spiritual bondage as well as physical bondage.
Okay. So could this be the great deceptions, like, you know, they talk about in the Bible,
there ain't no deception. The white man is a murderer and a thief and intimidator, and that's how he's gotten to be where he's at. They put out a report today about the CIA, the very secret government that really runs this government, that tells all the rest of the world how we are democratic and we observe human rights, and we're going around the world murdering and killing people every day to take control of their natural resources. We overthrow governments all over the world every month, either overthrow them or influence them through terror, murder, lies, and deceit. And that is how white people rule. They don't rule through intellect or spirituality.
Right.
You're talking about a culture and a civilization. You can't even call it civilized. What they're calling their civilization is murder cults that have united in order to intimidate the rest of humanity into doing what they want. Now, I don't know what other way I can put it.
That's fine. That's fine, Professor Spaulding. Is this why they incorporate so much of our culture? And, you know, because it seems like they're so free with doing magic and rituals and things like that. And, I mean, they have that whole industry on lock when you're trying
to... Yeah, but if they had magic, it would friggin' work. They don't have any magic. They have the propensity to take lives with impunity and scare the rest of us into accepting whatever else they got to say. Using ignorance as the base foundation. When you're ignorant, then somebody can threaten you with death. Do you know anybody alive that's not going to die?
No.
So how the hell can
not
somebody scare you with the inevitable, the absolute?
Wow, I didn't think
that
about
is
that.
Beautifully put, Professor. Beautifully put. That should take the CI law level for real.
Right. And so it is ignorance. It's the ignorance of reality.
Yeah.
You're ladies, you know, I know y'all are real attractive and beautiful and intelligent and spiritually sound women.
Thank you.
Am I telling the truth?
So
the
yes, you
brother.
Are.
Yes, brother, yes.
But guess what? You're nothing but colored greens. Your aspects of colored greens, turnip, carrots, lettuce, some chicken, some fish, et cetera, et cetera. What are we but every and all things that exist? All those things that we eat every day makes the cells in our body and allow us to be. We are those things, and those things are us. Everything that exists is a part of the one thing that the Africans in Togo, the Ewe people, call Sogbelisa. Sogbelisa. God is every and all things at once. And so the reason we can eat these other things and get the nourishment and the vitamins and the minerals to keep us going Because mm-hmm. we are all of those things.
Wow. Yeah. Wow.
We are all of those things.
Wow, it makes perfect
and that's
sense.
Why in the African world, the world that we refer to today as the Yoruba tradition, the Akan tradition, the Voodoo tradition, the Ewe tradition, that's why they all deal with nature and the living things in nature as their brothers mm-hmm. and sisters. Because they are. Mm-hmm. If they disappeared, if they didn't sacrifice themselves for you, you would die.
Right.
Yeah.
I get it. And they destroy
you. If you could not
nature.
Ingest them, yeah. you would die. So when mm-hmm. you eat your sister or brother, the carrot, mm-hmm. your cousin, the collard greens, give thanks to them. Because had it not been for their life, and here's what they do. These are aspects of the divinity
mm-hmm.
that is mm-hmm. serving the aspect of the divinity that is you by
mm-hmm.
breaking down the radiation and light from the sun, which the Africans in the Nile Valley call Ra, into mm-hmm. a usable food.
Mm. Yeah,
and what you're really eating is sunlight. Get it
right.
Now.
Right.
You know?
Indeed, indeed.
So,
I just had one more question on the Caucasian people, and this is it. So,
mm-hmm.
okay. okay, now, so we can liken them to, you know, how the scientists are, like, making clones or something like
they're
that?
They're like
so
holograms.
Okay.
They're holograms
okay.
of you.
Oh,
they could be made to look like you,
mm-hmm.
but they're just holograms, just a reflection. They don't really exist.
Wow.
Why, they run America, right?
Yes.
So why are we sitting down? Why do we have a million people in the streets of America telling them it is wrong to murder other human beings?
Right. Right.
If they're just civilized, intelligent
yes.
human, we sometimes have them make us pretend they are.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
All they got to say in the morning is done. This is wrong. This is evil. It doesn't happen no more.
Yeah,
but that's
it's
not what
like
they're saying.
Yeah.
I read some of the tweets. We're talking about people who are fundamentally evil at the core because they don't have the capacity not to be. And even those who pretend
mm-hmm.
and play act, we appreciate
mm-hmm.
that.
Mm-hmm.
But I know it's just play acting, get them in the right condition, and they lose the capacity to even pretend.
Wow.
Yeah.
So, and this is why you never see it over
in our history in America.
Yeah. And this is why you never see any white people just rallying for us just because they know we are going through something on a daily basis. You never see like a gang of them come together and be like, hey, this is wrong. You know.
Well, right now we're seeing hundreds of thousands of young white people
mm-hmm.
who
mm-hmm.
have been influenced culturally
mm-hmm.
by African Americans, especially after the Civil Rights Movement. The Civil Rights Movement really created an educational process to
mm-hmm.
humanize white people, because black folks didn't need humanizing.
Mm-hmm.
Civil Rights was not about us changing anything. That's what people make us think it was about. Civil Rights was about taking the animal that was white America and trying to turn it into a human being that could walk up, not just walk upright physically, but walk upright ethically and morally.
Mm. Wow.
You know?
Yeah.
And
yeah.
so it did have a great effect because at least 50% of the hundreds of thousands of people in the streets every night since the incident in Ferguson have been young white people. And I think that they're sincere.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know? Because
yeah.
they have grown up in a world where they haven't, because of the civil rights move, so many barriers of isolation,
mm-hmm.
that they have seen Africans differently from their mothers and fathers. But that's not all of them, because the ones on the police force represents the same generation, and they're murderers.
Mm-hmm.
And if they didn't pull the trigger, they're protecting the murderer, so that makes them also murderers.
Yeah.
Mm. So what do you think is going on with a lot of Caucasian people adopting black babies, like you see in the media, a lot of celebrities and What some is that about?
Some of them think from the bottom of their heart that they're doing something good.
Mm-hmm.
But most of what we see happening, see, the celebrities are the tip of the iceberg in this adoption, children of color from the Philippines, from Latin America, from Africa. I would think that most of them, like Jolie and others, really think this is what we can do, you know, to compensate for all of this other stuff that our people have done. So this is what we can do with our little bit of money to show we have humanity. But if you look around, a lot more of that is happening, not by the rich whites, but by these church groups and the middle-class whites, by the tens of thousands all over America. And I think it is an effort on their part, and all white populations. Now, listen to this really good, because some people are going to take it wrong, and I don't give a darn, but I don't want them messing with y'all. All white populations, the white population in Russia, the white population in Western Europe, the white population in Canada, the white population in the United States, all of them are at minus birth rate. Now, you know what that means? It means that they are not able to naturally give birth and stay up with natural death. They use a lot of artificial way of giving birth just to keep up with the death. And so, and they said this, they know what's going down. So they're going into extinction unless they unless they infuse into their gene pool some of this African stuff. So therein the need to adopt these African children or kidnap them, whatever they do, having babies, cross-racial, this whole cross-racial thing. They're trying to cut down on our thing with the whole gay movement, homosexual movement thing. And there's nothing in my culture that says that make any sense. A human rectum is not a vagina. I hadn't tried the rectum, but I know what a vagina is, and I don't. And nobody can confuse me. Okay,
right.
So we need to get it straight. And I'm not trying to offend anybody, because anybody who's in who sees themselves that way have been misled and injured and damaged, and need to get it straight. You know, if I see, I have all the brothers, I have brothers who are close to me. I have my genetic brothers out of my mother's belly. I love them. But I'm not playing around their sex organ pretending they're women.
Okay?
I have other brothers who are not of my mother's belly, comrades I've been struggling over years. I love them. And I would die for them.
Right.
But there's a difference between that and the woman upstairs that I've been married to for 44 years who I love, who have borne my children. When me and her come together physically, we recreate ourselves and imitate God.
Wow. And you know, Professor Smalls, it was funny because me and my sister were talking about this before the show, because I came across some information and I was a little, I was like, wow, you know, it kind of took me aback. And I asked, I said, I wonder what the conscious community thinks about this. So it's wonderful you brought this topic up, because there was a gentleman online, and he was talking about how the Dogon tribe, the Fulani tribes, different tribes that in
white
their
folks
culture,
and their Negro counterpart have gone out of the way, because nearly every African nation rejects this gay movement thing, and they've tried everything. They've cut off aids to these countries and all of this stuff. Because they want to use every weapon they can. You know, they're using that Ebola, which is created by America. There's three germ warfare, bacterial warfare laboratories in West Africa. One is in Liberia, one is in Sierra Leone, and one is in Guinea. They're run by Columbia University, Tulane University, and the CDC. Isn't it ironic that where they have these three labs that this thing broke out? Were they doing an experiment that went awry? Or they just didn't give a damn and threw it right out there straight up? But we better wake up. And so ignorance is our worst enemy. Ignorance of our sacred science. I am not going to define my reality by using the philosophy or the science of my murderer. Because when I do that, I will also become my murderer. Okay? I'm not going to use the way of the rapist as a way for me to determine my relationship to the woman, because I will too be a rapist.
Okay. God, so do you think that they had influence on the Dogon tribe saying this? Because they considered them gatekeepers.
What they're talking about, dual spirit, has nothing to do with homosexuality.
Okay.
The person who started this junk over here is Maladoma Somme. And I confronted Maladoma.
That was
when Maladoma wrote his first book, and I read the book, and I go like, wow. Because I'm an initiate. I'm an initiate in a number of African knowledge community or wisdom community, let's put it like that. I am a priest in the quote-unquote Yoruba tradition, which we call Ifa Orisha tradition. But I'm also an initiate in other traditions on the continent. And so when the book first came out, I sent the book to Maladoma's village, to his elders, and asked them, did you give him permission to do this? And someone said, well, who the hell is you to do that? I am me. You want to find out who I am? I've got speeches you can go back and read from 50 years ago. So find out who I am. So I sent it to his village, and his elder sent the letter back and said, we sent him to America to teach you. But at that time, he had not spoke before a single black audience. He had been teaching primarily white corporate males.
What?
All right.
Wow.
And it was only after my inquiry into his village that he began to drift into the African-American community. And in his book, a little book his wife wrote, who's divorced from him now, that little book on page 54, where she's talking about the dual spirit and gatekeepers to the realm of the ancestors, which he has since denied, but it's in the darn book. I got the book. And so he did a conference in New York some years ago on spirituality at Columbia University, and they used me, the young lady who was, I thought, a friend and a former student, used me to help her set up this conference on spirituality and said nothing about the homosexuality component of it until 2 weeks before. 2 weeks before, somebody called me about a flyer that was talking about dual spirit people. So I called and said, what do you mean by dual spirit people? And so I called some of my comrades, including my Babalao in Nigeria, and I said, Babalao, how do we stand on this? Are there any Odus that speak to this? And so Baba gave me the Odus that I needed and also tell me what the contemporary law in Nigeria was. And then I then called another Babalao friend of mine, Dr. Wade Nobles, who's also a psychiatrist in this country in California, and told Wade what was going on. And Wade decided, I'm going to come over there to stand with you, because I told him I'm confronting it. So when Dr. Nobles sent his thing in to pay for the conference, he said, oh, we would like for you to speak. So Dr. Nobles said, no, I don't want to speak, but I'd like to introduce Professor Small. And that's what he did. He took 45 minutes in his introduction of me. and then after I got to doing my lecture, because I was on the opening lecture, they closed all the rest of my workshop and wouldn't let me do any more workshop in the conference. Then Maladoma called for a private meeting with me, and him and I went around the corner to a restaurant, and it was supposed to be a private meeting, but he had two white male homosexuals and a couple of children. I'm a man of the truth. Tell him to come before his brother and speak to me. I tell the truth because he's my brother. I know how he got to be messed up like that. He had to tell the world how he got to be messed up. Tell him how the Catholic priest did this to him. Tell him that ritual that he's talking about in the first book of Fire and Water is a ritual to purify the homosexuality that had come from his rape and molestation as a child at the hand of these priests for 19 years of his life. Tell the world the truth.
And you are, so, oh my gosh, Dr. Smart, you are so on point, because in the guy that's on YouTube, he is a graduate of Princeton and Columbia. He said he's the first gay black Babalao king. He's on YouTube, and he has all these videos dressed like an Egyptian and everything.
And whoever that brother is, ask him how did he become gay. Ask him who molested him. Ask him how long did his molestation went on. Ask who is his pedophilia. You know?
Wow.
And so we need to go back and deal with reality. I don't have no hatred for my brothers and sisters who happen
right,
to be
exactly.
homosexual. They're just
exactly.
as damaged and injured as any of us.
Exactly.
We're damaged
exactly.
and
We're
injured
all.
In different ways from having been involved under the dominance of this white man's sickness,
mm-hmm.
you know, and his death drum. So, but I don't want to spend a lot of time dwelling on that.
Yeah,
no dwelling
yeah.
on white
we
people,
can lighten the mood up.
You know, the thing is that if we, anybody who wants to prove that any kind of behavior is appropriate, then show how that behavior leads to the reproduction of life.
Mm-hmm.
If that behavior does not lead to the recreation and the perpetuation of self, then you need to restudy and rethink that behavior because you're going into extinction.
Mm.
Yeah.
Wow.
That's right. That's what I would always say. If you did not reproduce, then if everybody was gay, then the world would end because nobody would
And how did they take that word out of the language and the word that meant beautiful and joyful?
And happy.
And how did they take that word and use it as the label for something that was considered to be abhorrent?
Wow.
But
right.
we're dealing with the Greco-Roman cultural phenomena and philosophy, which Christianity had masked and disguised for centuries, and now it doesn't think it needs a cover anymore.
No.
Okay.
Wow, this is some amazing information. I'm glad you brought this whole thing up because the dots are connected.
All I'm saying is reality is this, my dear sister. If you're going to continue to exist, you better have intercourse with the opposite sex and let that sperm go into you and let that egg and that sperm dance and recreate yourself.
Mm.
Just like God does. You become God for a day. In that moment, in that most sacred moment with the most beautiful feeling you will ever have in your life is when I release that sperm and you accept it with your egg, there ain't nothing like it on earth. And the reason it's the most beautiful feeling in the world because it is a feeling that allows you to recreate yourself just as God did. You get to play God for a moment.
Beautiful. Thank you. Go to heaven.
Woo.
It is heaven.
That was good. That was really good.
It is straight up heaven.
Heaven or earth.
But we need to understand our history. History will tell us what it is our ancestors believed. Our culture and our history. And then we will understand that before 1492, for 1,500 years, the Arabs and the Turks were enslaving Africans by the millions into Europe, the so-called Middle East, into Asia as far as China. The slave trade was alive and well. When Columbus and his people came to the west coast of Africa, they didn't start nothing. They just began to export it from the Mediterranean, from the Sahara, from the Indian Ocean into the Atlantic Ocean. And those same Arab Muslims, with some black Muslims along with them, we can't vindicate all of us because some of us was criminal too. You know, they were running the slave trade for 1,500 years. The white man didn't have to create a slave trade.
It was already in existence.
So we need to understand the history. And then even the people we're talking about, they weren't even Arabs. From the 8th century, the Turkish white man took over the Islamic system from the Arab. And the Arab haven't been in charge since, until after the First World War when the British put a bunch of half-breed people over Jordan and Saudi Arabia. But they didn't get there until after the First World War. From the 8th century until the First World War, the Turks and the Eastern European Serbs ran the Islamic world.
Wow.
So that's why understanding your history is just too important.
It is. I mean, how are they able to conquer us the way?
Because they have the capacity to kill.
Okay.
With impunity. Okay. If you come on a culture where life is the most important thing, and you come and you're facing a culture where you don't give a damn about life, you're in trouble. And we were in trouble. But now we have the capacity to kill. We just don't have the spirit to organize that killing. Now, if we can get the spirit to organize the killing to match our new found capacity to kill, we can kind of get out of this thing.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But we can get out without doing that.
Yes.
Because the European race, with all of its sickness, disease, his mental disease, his psycho-spiritual disease, his physical diseases, he's only 1/9 of the world's population.
Right.
Mm.
Why are we allowing 1/9 of the world's population to dominate us? Because he's got weapons of mass destruction. He's got weapons of death. Ebola is one weapon of death he's using to frighten 54 African nations into submitting. You hear what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. Yes, yes.
Okay. They dropped
like
two
said,
atomic bombs
anyway.
On a Japanese civilian population, and nobody calls it a crime against humanity. They didn't drop the bombs on any military compound. They dropped it in the heart of metropolitan Japan, two major cities, the two most crowded cities in Japan, killing mostly men, women, children, and old folks, and nobody calls it a crime against humanity. And they use that to intimidate the whole world so that they can have their way.
Oh, wow.
And so you want the truth.
Yes.
If you want the truth, then you have to become the truth. Zora Neale Hurston, our beautiful queen, says, to be there, you've got to go there. But to go there, you've got to know there. Okay? To be there, you've got to go there. But to go there, you've got to know there. And not be afraid. Know the truth, and the truth shall set you free.
Yes,
truth
indeed.
Alone will set you free. Study our history.
Mm-hmm.
You know, understand there's a book by Kujari. It's a history of mathematics. It's by a guy named Kujari. And in chapter one of his introduction, or paragraph one or two of the introduction, this guy in writing the philosophy of history quotes Plato from Phaedrus. Phaedrus is the only document we know that came from Plato's hand. The Republic is Aristotle writing about Plato, but Phaedrus is supposed to be Plato having a dialogue that gets written down. And in Phaedrus, Plato says, the African, but the Egyptians are calling us by their word for black, which is Ethiopia, or Ethiopia, which means burnt face. So Ethiopia is not an African word. It's a Greek word that means black, connotes black. It suggests black, burnt face. And so he says that the Ethiopians have given us, this is Plato now, this is their big boy, he's big up, you know.
Right,
He says that the Ethiopians, the black folks, have given us arithmetic, they have given us geometry, they've given us medicine, they've given us juice, and he names a number of the sciences. But he said the greatest science of all they've given us is the science of writing itself. Now, do anybody ever quote that in a classroom?
They sure don't.
No, that's what I'm saying. Knowing your history. Or do you know that Europe is named after an African princess named Europa?
Europa, yes.
The granddaughters of one of the pharaohs of Kemet? Or that whole story they play out on TV on about Troy. What's the sister's name? Something of Troy.
Helen Troy.
Helen. Helen. But they don't tell you that Helen is a black woman. That's why the white guy have a problem because his white son falls for this black woman. But they give you this blonde, right? All you got to do is read Herodotus' book two. Didn't they say Herodotus was the father of history? But when we started quoting Herodotus, it's, he didn't know what he was talking about. But you call him the father of your history. But let's go back to spirituality.
Okay.
And let's deal
thanks for that history lesson.
Awakening to God. But the only way you can awaken the God within is with the truth of yourself and your being. You know? And that's why when we deal with religion, because we have so many of our people enslaved in Christianity and Judaism and Islam in America, with Christianity being the biggest enslaver. And so let me just give you a definition that I use for religion. First, I said religion is a tool of spirituality.
Mm-hmm.
Religion is a tool of
yes,
spirituality.
Indeed, yes.
So
yes.
Religion has its place.
Mm-hmm.
But when it loses its roots, it's out of place.
Mm.
And so the word religion, R-E-L-I-G-I-O-N, comes from a Greek word, or two Greek words, R-E,
mm-hmm.
which means to do over, you know,
Greek.
Or to go back.
Uh-huh. Right.
And ligio, which means to bind. So the word religion
mm.
means to bind back.
Bind back.
Bind back.
Back.
To bind back
okay.
to something. What is it you're trying to bind back to? It is the wisdom
right.
of your ancestors.
Wow.
The wisdom of your ancestors. You know?
Wow.
Religion
right.
means, I said, religion means to bind back. It
okay.
Religious systems that bind a people or a person back to the wisdom, the worldview, or culture of their ancestors, and should bring about a belief binding the spiritual nature of a person or a group to a supernatural or divine being. And it doesn't do that anymore.
Mm-hmm.
It gets you to worship
mm.
the image of the person who's doing all the work of the devil. So in short,
mm-hmm.
you walk into your church, there's some white dude up there with a beard and a robe. He just murdered you down the street, lynched you around the corner, practiced fraud to you across the bridge, you know, just stole your property and put you out in the street.
Right.
Shot you down and claim he's the police and got it right and put you in prison. And then you go to pray to God and the image in front of you is the guy that just did all of those things. Tell me how you going to work that shit out in your conscience. I'm sorry. No profanity. It's radio. Sorry,
oh,
sorry, sorry.
You good. You good.
Wow.
So,
wow.
But that's not, but let's come back and deal with a couple of realities now. Most African Americans, in terms of food, clothing, shelter, safety, is not living in poverty. And
right.
we need to get that straight.
Mm-hmm.
Most African Americans is not living in poverty. But our numbers are so large that the segment that is living in poverty is extraordinary.
Yeah.
Mm.
And because that segment, was it 2, 3, 4 million, 5 million, because it is so large, it impacts the rest of us, the 60 to 80 million.
Right.
In such a negative way that it makes the whole community appear to be living in poverty. Now, I'm
mm-hmm.
only talking about physical poverty.
Mm-hmm.
When it comes to
okay.
spiritual poverty, all of us are there.
Yeah.
When it comes to intellectual poverty, the African-Americans in the worst state he's ever been in.
Mm.
That goes from Oprah to Mr. Cosby, as you can see the mess going on around him, having lived in that white world with that weird desire for those weird, I don't know what that's about, you know. But
yeah.
But that happens when you're damaged,
mm.
you know.
Mm.
And so they like to create O.J. Simpson, and when the O.J. Simpsons act like them, then they act surprised. You know, Bill
yeah,
Cosby,
yeah.
they create the Bill Cosby when it acts like them, they act surprised. Well, I'm not
yeah.
surprised.
Yeah.
But we'll leave that right there.
Yeah.
Let's come back to finding the divine within. So we just have to listen to Mary Mary. You know,
mm-hmm.
it's the God
yeah.
in you.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Because
and you know they got a lot of backlash for that song with from the Christians.
I'm sure they did, because these Christians don't want to accept the God in them, because somebody got them looking up in the sky
mm-hmm.
and looking for. You, and oh, the sister told me that I wish I had gotten it right. And I know someone was listening. She was telling me how her little boy says, "Oh, then when you know the story I was telling about the child who wondered
yeah.
if the white people worship Jesus,
uh-huh.
then." The little boy said, oh, so that's kind of like the Batman emblem being flashed up in the sky. So that's kind of like Christians. They're
yeah.
looking at this hologram of a white man up in the sky and calling it God.
Yeah.
Only because it has the capacity to intimidate, murder, steal, rob, and plunder them on earth and inflict such fear in them, they figure only God could inflict that kind of fear in you. So when they see an image of that same murderer flashed into the sky as a hologram of divinity, they bow down.
Mm-hmm.
You tell any preacher they want, give them my telephone number. Tell them call me. Because how would you dare call yourself a man of God and a woman of God with your people being in the condition they're in. You got to be ashamed to even use the word in your mouth.
Yes, Professor Small, do you feel like a lot of these pastors know the truth of our history and they just suppress it?
Look at the word you just used. What did you call them?
Pastors.
Say it again, pastors.
Pastors.
Yeah, it went right past them. And they went right past the truth. No, most of them don't know their history.
Mm-hmm.
They're brothers in the penitentiary that have more of a conscious understanding of what a pastor should be than most of the people in the pulpits.
Mm-hmm.
And most of these people up in the pulpit, look at how they dress on Sunday. They use all of the images of the pimp and the hustler to inspire and motivate the people. What's that about?
Yeah, what is that about? You know,
it's about pimping and hustling. That's what it's about.
That's what they pimp you.
The hoes are sitting
priest,
all on the front row.
A priest or a preacher, like in my day when I was a little boy growing up on a plantation in South Carolina, Pop and them didn't take no salary. They work a job all day. My granddaddy was a carpenter and a brick mason along with my daddy and them, and they worked every day to make their living.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Preaching in that church was serving the people.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Now you got these people running churches like it's some corporate structure for them and their family, and sending their children to, one daughter goes to school to be the undertaker for the church, and the other son goes to school to be the lawyer for the church, and the other one goes to school to be the preacher to replace him. So the church had become a family corporate dynasty now. Pimping and hustling, just like they did on the plantation, except now it's in blackface. That's not all the churches. They must be. I know God wouldn't be that mean to us. There got to be some good black churches out there. And
so
I'm not talking to y'all. I'm not talking to the good black church. God bless y'all. I'm not talking to the pastor and the preacher who's doing all they can to help the sick, to help fix the broken bones and fix the broken hearts and the broken mind. I'm not talking to y'all. I'm ready to serve y'all. I'll come speak to your church for free. I'm talking to the demons that's exploiting our people in the name of God. And you know who they are, because y'all sit in the same conventions together, and they bite you every day. You know? So they know who I'm talking to. I believe what Malcolm said, the secret to life is to have enough fear. I wasn't created by none of you. I wasn't created by the Marxist Leninists. I wasn't created by the so-called white liberal left. I was not created by the Christian church nor the Muslim community. I am that I am. I'm from my divine. Through my mama and my daddy and my grandpeople and my great-grandpeople and my great-great-grandpeople and my great-great-great-grandpeople until I get back to God itself. God is my master. And God is not a person nor a thing. It is every and all things, including me and you, if you wake up to it. That's what my ancestors said, and I believe them because they love me. And I love them. And then the other piece I want to give you, and then we'll come and find another space to go to.
Okay.
And I'm going to read over that one piece again about the genes. I want you to listen to it good now, because then I'm going to show you something.
Okay.
The genes, the DNA of God, the divine. That's what your genes is. Your genes is the DNA of God. Ancestors are your pedigree. You learn your pedigree from your history. God is your original ancestry. If people define themselves by referring to their origin, we are the best of our ancestors' genes. We are the latest version of our ancestors. We are the highest tech version of our ancestors. Our children are the best of our genes, the latest version of those genes, and the highest tech model. Now, what does that say? You are your ancestors. Don't be looking in the graveyard for your ancestors, because before they died, they deposited themselves into one another and created you out of them. You are them. You are their eternity. They didn't die. They simply body jumped.
Wow.
Think about it.
Beautiful.
Think about it.
Beautiful.
Everything that makes you up came from your mama and daddy, right? Mm-hmm. And everything that made those two people and everything that made them up in order for them to make you up came from the four people who were their mothers and daddies, right?
Right.
And everything that mm-hmm. made them up in order to make your parents, grandparents up came from their mom and daddy, which is the eight people, which came from the 16 people, which came from the 32 people, which came from the 64 people. Hey, then it goes back infinitely until it gets to God as the genesis of the whole process. And you're nothing but an extension of God's manifestation of itself as a human being. So you are the ancestors. They're not gone. You know, and in the Yoruba tradition, they have a term for it. It's called Awo. And in the process of Awo, they said that we come and go. And that we have seven times to be born, because the Yoruba believes in reincarnation. But they don't believe that you reincarnate as a plant or a butterfly, a bird, or an animal. The Yoruba belief, as all African beliefs that explain reincarnation, you reincarnate as a human in the same blood family you originally incarnated in. And you have seven times to reincarnate in that family. And each of the seven times you have eight steps you must develop ethically and morally and master, so that at the end of your seven, having done seven times eight complete developmental process, you go back to divinity and become a part of its integrity again as God, or what the West calls heaven.
Wow.
Okay.
And Yoruba is the oldest religion.
No,
correct?
No one knows what the oldest is. We know that we're just old. We're older than any other people on earth.
Okay.
So it's just one of the ways. But the Congo system is pretty much the same. The Zulu system is pretty much the same. The only thing that's different is the ecology they're trying to explain themselves in. So if I'm in the desert and I want to define hope, the symbol I use for hope in the desert would be different from the symbol I use for hope if I'm in the rainforest. But both the symbol will represent the concept hope.
Okay.
You understand?
Okay. Yes. Yes.
I'm going to shut up.
Oh.
You can ask me some questions.
Oh, I didn't mean to cut you off. I just really, really want to know, what do you think about multidimensional beings? I guess better known as... I'm 37.
You're a multidimensional being.
Okay.
Do you have children?
Yes. Two sons.
Mm-hmm. Where did they come from? You borrowed them from somebody?
No.
You bought them from somebody? Where did they come from?
Me.
You walked around for 9 months, right?
Yes.
Really, the total thing is 10 months. Mm-hmm. While this gestation period is going, while this part of you and your mate, because you only contributed 50% of that. The rest came from a seed that came from a male, right?
Right, yes.
And in your belly, all of the thoughts you had, all of the sounds you experienced, all of the trauma you experienced, all of the joy you experienced got woven into those two boys.
Mm.
All of the memory you had got woven into those boys. All of the disappointment, all of it got woven into their nervous system. They're nothing but an extension of you.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
They're a multidimensional creature. The only multidimensional creature are us.
Okay.
We are the only gods you'll ever know. People say, how can I see God? Break out a mirror. If you see another god other than that one you see in that mirror, you're confused.
Oh, wow.
And we are confused, trust me. Because you can't tell me all these churches in our community, all this praying we do on Sundays, all the praying we in the condition we're in, hell no. Something wrong with that. Okay, go play somebody else.
That's right.
I'm not going to let you play me anymore. You know? So let's be real. Let's deal with what's real, you know.
Yes, yes, yes.
And when you bring that creature into this world, you didn't bring them here for nobody to shoot down in the street, for nobody to take in a school and psychologically abuse. while they're still in kindergarten, to have some pervert who don't know their gender molesting them and practicing pedophilia on them?
I'm telling you, this is sick what's going on nowadays. I mean, it's
so
just
this
so
has
much...
always been going on. It's just not as under the cover as it used to be.
Mm-hmm.
There's nothing new about the behavior of these people.
Yes,
except now they got us. They've gotten us to adopt their way. So we bring in all the power and the energy of Africa to this perversion.
Mm.
You know, and that's why we need to raise up African spirituality and raise up African truth.
Yes, yes.
You know?
And they have schools catering to this with truth. You know,
they're trying to get the school system that you serve to cater to it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, this brown creep out in California just passed some kind of ordinance to teach homosexuality in all the public schools.
And
I don't see the Africans need to rise up. So you committing a crime against me, you know.
Yeah.
And see, we
got to
let folks know, like, you make me sad, I make you sad. You make me cry, I make you cry. You give me a funeral, I give you a funeral. That's how you change people's bad habits.
That's true.
I hope
that's
I said
true.
That nice enough so nobody will get y'all in trouble.
You said it the way you were supposed to say
okay.
it.
Okay.
Yeah, no hold guard on this show.
Yeah.
We don't hold
right.
back.
Okay.
No.
So
yeah.
spirituality
no
is your being aware of and completely involved in your reality.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Spirituality is your comprehending, your involving, and your consciousness of your reality. Because your reality only has relevance that you are conscious of if you are spiritually engaged in creating it. See, some people's reality is being created by forces outside of themselves. But people who are free, your reality is created by the spiritual force that comes from you.
Right.
You know? Okay. So spirituality is being conscious of and actively involved in your reality.
Wow.
And so, you know, these are the things we're going to be talking about on Saturday.
Okay.
And I hope that some people are willing to learn. If you say you're black, let it go further than just a hairdo and a piece of cloth. And let's see if blackness has something to do with history and consciousness and a body of knowledge that, you know, I touched on a little bit with the pyramid text. The coffin text, or the book of the coming forth by day, or the book of gates. We have all of these African spiritual books, thousands of pages long, before the Torah, Bible, or the Quran. And almost everything you'll find in the Torah, Bible, or the Quran comes from those books.
Wow. And you said it's called pyramid text.
Yeah, the pyramid text. You can buy it.
Okay.
Yeah, the coffin text.
Okay.
You have the book of Gates, E-A-T-E-S, and then you have, they call it the book of the dead, but the African word for it is the Per-Em-Heru, the book of the coming out of the darkness into the light, or the book of the coming forth by day.
Okay.
It's all the same word. And then you can go into the Ethiopian, the Ethiopian book of the dead, you know.
Okay. Have you read the Emerald Tablets before?
The Emerald Tablets?
Yes.
I've heard of them, but if it wasn't done by Africans, I'm not interested.
Yes, it's about what thought, T-H-O-T-H, thought.
Thought? That's some white folks stuff. They're trying to make up stuff to give themselves some validity. I ain't interested. I got my stuff. Let me master my mama and daddy first, and then I'll look and see if anything else have any relevance.
But I'm not interested,
I'm in America, right? I'm sitting up here in New York, right? My mother and father came from Georgetown, South Carolina. Their mother and fathers came from Georgetown, South Carolina. My grandmama's father came from Uganda, or that area. Mm-hmm. He was a Tutsi man. On the other side, her mom, Hope, was a Native American, African Native American woman from the eastern shores of the Carolinas. On the other side, my great-grandpa, great-great-grandpa, because Peedee was born here, came from Ghana, you know. And
wow.
then his wife was Native American, African Native American, from the Creek people, but along the coast. Well, we come from what they call the Chicora Nation. And the Chicora Nation, when they started defining Native American, they said the Chicora Nation was so black, they wouldn't give them the definition of Native Americans until 1972.
Whoa.
But, you know. Well, and there's one of our brothers who have written, I think he lives right in D.C., and I forgot his name. He's written a nice piece on the Africans who were here before the white folks got here. So I love my history because those old people saved enough of it, even when I just give you just fragments, but there were enough fragments to make me see I am.
Mm-hmm.
I am. And so nobody's going to make me other than what I am.
Yes. So,
and
we
like
see
a lot
you
of people, let me just show you a note, right?
Mm-hmm.
Ask anyone, when Malcolm X was assassinated, right?
Mm-hmm.
Who took over as the imam of his mosque? I did. I did.
You did. Wow.
I did.
Hmm.
Now, I just threw that out there in case anybody want to challenge me on certain things.
Right.
I am the imam of the Muslim Mosque, Inc., who took over after the death of Hajj Malik Shabazz. I was then El Hajj Amin Shahid, imam of the Muslim Mosque, Inc. So I'm not just talking out of darkness, folks.
Okay.
I do have a little bit of background here.
Mm-hmm.
I am 69, which means I've been there. I was 21 years old then when that occurred. But not,
wow.
and I don't play that because if I wanted to be the big man who succeeded Malcolm, I had 49, close to 50 years to do that card.
Right.
I just kept doing the work. But I dropped it tonight since I'm dropping some science and some of them have to do the Islam and the history. I want people to know I sat before the Rabat Alim al-Islamim. That's called the World Muslim League. That's like the Vatican for Islam. It sits in Mecca. And most African-American Muslims who pray five times, they don't even know it exists. They don't know their worlds are being manipulated by some other people who don't even have our interests at heart as a race. That's another story.
Yes, I can only imagine.
So, we're going to have fun on Saturday talking about African culture.
Okay.
We're going to talk about the Obosun. The Obosun are the lay people. So they're the deities of the Akan people. But no Africans talk about no deities. All Africans talk about the oneness of God. And then they talk about the aspects of the divine that we experience every day, the forces of nature.
Mm-hmm.
That's what the Orishas are. And in the voodoo, we'll be discussing the voodoo a little bit. In the voodoo, the forces of nature are called Lowas. You know?
Lowas.
And in Ghana and Ivory Coast, among the Akan people, the forces of nature are called Obosum. You know?
Obosum.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so what the ancestors said is that everything could be broken down into its component parts.
Mm-hmm.
Including the divine.
Okay.
And so it says that you can't the divine is too massive for you to comprehend. But you can comprehend those aspects of it, those component parts of it, those forces of it that is in the ecology that you create and recreate yourself in.
Right, absolutely.
You understand?
Yes. Yes.
We have some callers on the line.
Oh, no, that's fine. Yeah, I like to deal with
it. All right. We're going to go with area code 202-281. You're on. You have a question, comment, or sip and tea?
Greetings. This is Patricia Patton.
Good evening, Sister Patricia. Girl, I didn't even call your name. We got to remind people why I'm even on the show, sisters. Tell them about Sister Patton and the program we're doing on Saturday.
Yeah.
Come on, Pat. Lay it out. Tell people what we're doing.
Oh, okay. This is Patricia Patton. My event marketing company is Abaca 6. And I decided I wanted to create this event because I love Brother Small so much, and he just has informed me spiritually so in depth that we had to bring him back again. He came and was a keynote speaker in March at my first event that I've ever done in consciousness. And ever since I saw him on Hidden Colors 2, I've just been attracted to his energy and what he had to provide because it's so truthful. So I wanted him to come back and speak in depth about the God essence, what we truly are as we exist as and created as. And I wanted people to understand the difference between the false self, the ego, and who we truly are, because I see it a lot in the consciousness community, and it's kind of bewildering to me that we have these platforms where people speak and they're not living that life. So I really wanted him to take it from an African standpoint in spirituality and not religion, of who we are and as the indigenous people of the earth, and from that standpoint. So.
Beautiful, beautiful.
Thank you,
all
Sister
right.
Pat.
Thank you, Patricia.
Thank
you're
you, Patricia.
Welcome. And I was just told that my flyer doesn't look like it shows too much on how people can get in contact with me. But I thought
please,
that was pretty explicit.
Okay.
You can go to the website to purchase tickets up until midnight on the 12th of December at www.thedotconnection.net, or you can call me directly at area code 323-929-7724. I'm also on Facebook at Patricia Patton, and I have a community page as well called the Truth to Power. That's Truth Number 2 Power on Facebook. And I'm on Twitter at Yamiya Love. I'm all over the social
tell
media
everything, Patricia. Tell them all.
And I'm also on Instagram at Abacus6 as well. So I invite everyone to come out and truly get this in-depth lecture from Brother Small, because he has so much to offer. He is such a great spirit, and I'm so honored to be able to, you know, sit at his feet and be able to be taught by him. I'm really honored, and I have so much gratitude for you, Brother Small.
Thank you, Sister Pat, and I for you. And let me tell the people something. You know, like, I'm not a anti-Muslim or anti-Christian or anti-Hebrew, because all three of those forms of worship, which we only are into because the white man who was into it conquered us. Had the Chinese people conquered us, we'd be into Buddhism and Taoism. But since the people who had taken these pieces of our culture, and that's what Judaism, Christianity, and Islam is, they're pieces, fragments of African history, culture, and spirituality, and that has been repackaged by Europe and given to us. And so I understand that, and I'm not going to blame an enslaved African for the scars that they bear from slavery. I'm going to do my best to show you how to understand how you got the scar and try to show you how to put yourself in a position where no one can scar you ever again. So I love most of my biological and genetic brothers and sisters. They're in the church. I'm going home for the Christmas holiday. I don't celebrate it, but I'm going to be with them. And they love me. I mean, I remember years ago, you know, when I first started getting into what people now today call the conscious movement. This is like, you know, almost 50 years ago. My family was a myth, some of my siblings, but my mother was my best supporter, my grandma, and my big brother Andrew. So I always had this support from the family. And I remember about 30 years ago, my siblings actually sent me a trophy, you know.
Wow.
To tell me they love me.
That's beautiful. You know,
they sent me a trophy to say, we love you. They didn't understand what I was doing, but they loved me for doing it. You know.
Wow.
And so I love them too, but they know that. I'm their big brother, you know. They know that I love them immensely. And the reason I'm going south, because I still have three sisters that live there and their children and grandchildren. So I'm going to commune with them and to go to my parents' grave site and spend a little time hanging out with them. And then I'll come back up this way. But for brothers and sisters who are Christians especially, I can show you how Jesus is a juju man. See, y'all don't understand. I can show you how to read that book. So you'll understand when Mary and Martha, you know, saying, oh, Mary, don't you weep, oh, Martha, don't you moan. And so when Jesus goes and bring Lazarus back to life, you think that's a beautiful thing, but when the voodoo priests do it, you want to say there's something wrong with that. You know? So was Jesus a voodoo priest? Was he an Obeah man?
Mm.
Hey, you know? He was walking on water. The only people that do things like that are voodoo priests. You know?
But
we need to just pay attention to what we are doing, because the white man, the European man, I hate to call him a white man because there ain't nothing white about him, but the European man, he wasn't smart enough to mess the material up. He was just smart enough to keep you from understanding the mess he created of the material. Most of that written material, and I think it was the last pope, not this one, the one before him, went to Cameroon, I think in 09, and it was in Newsday magazine. What is it, Newsday? Yeah. And he told the people of Cameroon, because he was trying to get the Africans of West Africa to come back to the Catholic Church. And he said, did y'all know that of the 10 primary writers of Christian theology, that 7 of them was African?
Oh, wow.
Wow, we won't hear that.
Of the 10 primary, this is the Pope now, La Papa. Of the 10 primary authors of the original Christian theology, 7 were Africans. Okay?
That is a lot.
And that's why I say Judaism, Christianity, and Islam are nothing more than fragments from the periphery of the African spiritual system.
Definitely.
And it's been repackaged by Europeans and given to us. And we've used it very well to survive. But we put a lot of voodoo and a lot of Yoruba and a lot of stuff into the Christian church. You go to any good, and I was talking to you today, sis, about the church you belong to, came out of, right? And so you're saying you were raised in the Catholic community, but you went to the Baptist church. Well, if you go into a white Baptist church in D.C. and then go into a black Baptist church, you will go into two different churches. What is the difference? One is European and one is African. What is African about the African one? That's what you need to know. When you find that secret, you would have found the hidden gems that our ancestors put into these Christian churches that we are part of. But we don't see the African hidden gems because we don't know African history. So you're stepping on something that you don't even recognize. You're sitting on something you don't recognize because you've never seen a prototype of it. But once you study your history and you see the prototypes, the philosophical prototypes, the ideological prototypes, you know, the cultural prototypes, the spiritual prototypes, when you see it again in the Christian church, you'll recognize it as being yours and not theirs. And that what we've done, we've taken the European Christian shell and we made it to house an African spiritual expression. But we've forgotten how we did that. So we think we just white folks in blackface now. You understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
So tell my Christian brothers and sisters, come on out, let's hang. We'll kick Jesus around a little bit. We're going to talk about the Lord. You know, we're going to see what he was really trying to teach you, and let's see if that's what the preacher is teaching you. You know, there's a body of wisdom in the Bible, and it's a deep body of wisdom.
Yes, it is.
But they're giving you some theological schools reinterpretation crap and trying to make you think that's the word of the ancients. But you better beware of the deception.
All right, now.
You know.
Here we go. We have another caller. We have a whole lot of callers.
Thanks
for calling,
let's take more callers. I'll shut up.
Okay.
Thanks for calling,
Patricia. Yeah. Okay, we're going to go to area code 678. Question, comments. Hold up. Oh. Area code 678, question, comment, or sip and tea.
Hello.
Hello. Welcome to
Hi.
so glad I got in where I fit in.
Hey, you do.
Squeeze and win.
And peace to the Baba. I am absolutely, positively honored to even be listening to this show. And peace to you, sisters, for putting it out there. I am in love with it. and Baba, I actually spoke to you. I know your godson, Kevin, just a couple of weeks ago. And he told, I said, what? That's your godfather? What? Oh, my goodness. But at any rate, I was born and raised Southern Baptist, so and my father's a minister.
Okay.
And I studied under Dr. Asa Hillier at Georgia State for some years, and that's how I actually...
Oh, girl, you had a God for a teacher. That was a bad brother. That's one of my teachers, too.
Yes, it was definitely a big hit when he transitioned. But
I know, yeah.
He's still with me. He's still with me, certainly. And I'm blessed to have people like yourself, Ashra Quasi, and other people, Baba Baruti, Mama Marimba, you know, who have kind of taken me under their wings. But this whole Christian thing, you know, it's like... You shake it, but you can't quite shake it when you're in a family full of Southern Baptists.
I come from one. My granddaddy was a preacher, too, in St. Anne's Baptist Church.
So, but I guess my question and I guess kind of comment, I've been kind of building with some sisters lately, and we certainly feel the urge to really totally understand African spirituality in its totality so that we can... be clear on how we can move forward with the work that we must do that ancestors have put us here for. And one thing that came up in conversation, and you kind of mentioned it when you talked about the concepts being matching kind of like the environment, and I'm paraphrasing you, but someone came up with the whole concept of African Americans have to figure out what African spirituality means to them here in this land. And as African American, so can you kind of give? And I thought that
I'm one of the foremost proponent of that. As a matter of fact, I may have been the first one to really go there like that.
Awesome.
But I'm really not, because if you go back to the 1800s, mm-hmm. Bishop MacNeil Turner, who was the first black man to be made a clergy in the American military, MacNeil Turner told us back then, and you got to figure this stuff. Here's his brother. 1800, Civil War is just over, and he's saying you need a black god, and that everyone's god should reflect their ethnicity. Okay? That was deep. Mm. And he went further. You had sisters. There was an organization of sisters. They called themselves the Afro-American. They were part of a group called the Afro-American League. This is 1892. Dig the year now, 1892, and they call themselves the Afro-American League, founded by Brother T. Thomas Fortune. Well, there was a woman, it was a woman group that gave them the impetus, because there was these sisters fighting to abrogate Negro and use the word Afro-American in 1892.
What?
Okay. So we've been fighting for a long time, and sisters have been leading the fight, but that's why it's so important that we learn our own history.
Yes.
Because
yes.
If you don't know your history, you don't know your pedigree.
Mm-hmm. That's true. That's
absolutely
true. And
so the African Americans, just like the Yoruba, wasn't always living where they're at, and they weren't always approaching the divinity through the methodologies they're using today. They lived someplace else, and their ancestors approached it differently. We no longer live on the continent of Africa.
Right.
And we're not just Yorubas. We come from, especially North America, we're made up of almost every ethnic nation in Africa.
Mm-hmm.
And so what we have to do, though, we have to learn the basic fundamentals of the sacred science of our ancestors so that we can recreate ourselves here in North America. Because we are a new people. When our brothers politically were saying the new African nation, we are a new African nation. And it is no more of a contradiction than the Zulu, being Zulus, being South African, and being African. You understand? I'm an African-American. That's my ethnic identity. I'm an American. That's my geopolitical national identity. And I'm an African. That's my racial identity. But what we haven't gotten together is our ethnic identity, our African-American cultural, spiritual identity. Because your identity is rooted in the experiences you've had over a significant period of time, and your response to that experience in relationship to the environment you are in, and your response to how that environment treats you and how you must respond and reflect that environment. That's how you establish your identity and your rituals and your sacred moments, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. We haven't done that. Who is I to be Wells to us? Is she our saint? Is she our angel? Who's Harriet Tubman? Is she our prophet? Who's Dr. King? Have we defined them to us as a group? We haven't done it. Mm-hmm. Yet our entire experience in this country have been an experience that is one of the most extraordinary of any peoples in history.
Yeah.
1912, hell, we burned, not 1917, 12, we burned New York down.
Mm-hmm.
Burnt it down in a response to the enslavement and tyranny. But does anybody talk about that?
No.
Is that date sacred to us?
Mm-hmm.
In 1720 something, I forgot the year, you had the Stoner Rebellion in South Carolina, near Walterboro. It was one of the largest armed rebellion of blacks in America up to that day. And for the longest time until Nat Turner.
Mm-hmm.
And most of the brothers and sisters were escaping, going to the Promised Land. How many people know where our Promised Land was? It was in Florida, where St. Augustine, Florida, is today. And we built an enormous fort, which is still there, called Fort Moses.
Wow.
And there was no Seminole Indians. The Seminole Indians, as a result of the genetic amalgamation between the Creek Indians and the Africans.
You know? Yeah, I heard that.
And so if we know our history, we can define ourselves spiritually and use the forces of nature that we've discovered in America, just like others have used it wherever they've discovered themselves to be, having a common experience.
Mm-hmm.
But that is the job. And, you know, sister, I'm glad you're doing it, because in most of history it has always been the women who've done this.
Mm-hmm.
The men, you assign us to take it and run with it, but it has been the women who's done this.
Yeah.
You know?
Wow.
So it's called birthing yourself, birthing your nation, birthing your culture, birthing your spirituality by using your histology.
Wow. That really answered the question, because I always said one thing that one of the elders always tell me is you must know your history, you must know your ancestors, but I don't have the privilege to, because I only know my immediate family, and a lot of my other family has passed or it's just broken relationships, so we can't really get to them. So I will always say, well, I need to know my history. I need to know my history.
You want me to help you with that a little bit?
Yes. A little
bit. How did you come into being?
A
mother. Through a test tube?
No,
okay.
Mother and father.
Mm-hmm. They got fresh, right?
Yeah, they got fresh.
And enjoyed themselves, didn't they? They had fun making you. You realize that, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But guess what they did? They deposited, as you, billions of years of memory.
Mm. Wow.
Those billions of years of memory is embedded in the cells and the nerve endings of your body. Restore yourself spiritually through the right eating habits, good exercise, things that we take for granted that's simple, that's very African.
Mm-hmm.
Eating appropriately, exercising, thinking appropriately, learning how to love again, and don't confuse sexuality as love. Sex is something people who love do.
Mm-hmm.
That's when it's really beautiful. know, it can feel good other times, but when you're making love to somebody you love, that shit is off the chain. That's a whole nother reality there. So, but what is it that you love? What you love is not the person, because all of us are worthy of loving if we just accept the person, but you have to learn the divine in you. Develop the God in you and let the God in you recognize the God in the other person. And if that other person has developed the God in them and the God in you will find common bond. That's love right there.
Mm-hmm.
See? That's love.
Beautiful. Yes.
Wisdom.
And that's a hard task because someone has convinced us that love is attraction.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that love is habitual attachment.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that love is emotional response to stimuli.
Mm-hmm.
No.
Mm. Right.
Love is when the God in me meets the God in you.
Mm-hmm.
But the God in me can't meet the God in you until I become conscious of the God in me.
Mm.
And you become conscious of the God in you.
Wow.
I'll make sure I tell my son that when he want a girlfriend.
That's right. I've been working on mine for years. They're married, and I'm still working on them. Because that's my job as the father.
Right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Well, thank you. That was a beautiful, you put a beautiful spirit right there. Like
yes.
That. On that piece.
Thank you. I appreciate all of you all.
But don't stop. Now, when you study the history of your immediate family, then study the history of the African-American community they came from, then study the history of the African-American region that the community is in, then study the general history of the African-American. Read LaRon Bennett, Before the Mayflower. Also read LaRon Bennett's The Shaping of Black America. Those two books by Bennett was extraordinary. And don't do anything until you read Cottage E. Woodson, The Miseducation of the Negro.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
those three books will have you walking on water.
And you said The
Shaping of Black America by LaRon Bennett.
Okay.
And Before the Mayflower by LaRon Bennett. They're just enormous pieces of work. And then Dr. Cottage E. Woodson, The Miseducation of the Negro.
And you know Dr. Hill, you had us read that in his class.
Right. So you know. But read it again. I read it again a few months ago, and it blew my mind. I said, Jesus, I didn't understand aspects of it when I first read it, it the second or third time. But when I read it a few months ago, it just reawoke me.
Okay.
And you know, the last thing Asa said to me, we were out in a few months before he died. Each year, him and Dr. Nobles and myself, we were going out to Kansas City to work with an African-centered school system out there in Missouri, and we were setting up our PowerPoint in the auditorium, and Asa was acting a little different. Not like he was sick or anything, but just not the Asa, you know? And so I asked him what was wrong, and he says, Brother Small, because that's what people call me. They don't call me Professor Small. Everybody knows me. Call me Brother Small. He said, Brother Small, he says, you know, we're but spirits in transition. And I remember the minute he said that, I knew he was getting ready to leave.
Oh, wow.
And he left about 2 months later. But he said, we're but spirits in transition. And he said, I want you to make sure you tell the people that we are in a war.
Mm-hmm.
We've won the political war, and we've done well in the economic war, but unless we win the cultural war, the political and economic won't even matter.
Mm-hmm.
And at the center of your culture is your spirituality. And at the center of your notion of spirituality is your divinity. So you've got to win the culture war to restore the integrity of your spirituality and to, again, have ascend is your notion of divinity.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
So I'm glad to meet one of my little sisters from Ace's heart. So thank you, sis.
Thank you.
All right.
Okay, we're going to try to get a couple, at least one more caller in. We're out of time. We're just going to let it go.
Oh,
wow. Time went by fast.
So fast.
Keep the energy going. Okay. Area code of 513. You're on. Question, comment?
Comment first to Dr. Smalls. It's like that first lady said, it's just a pleasure to be on the same line with you, you know, just watching your videos, like, and when I seen it come up in my news feed, I was like, oh, I'm staying awake for this.
Oh, thank you, sister.
So I just consider it a privilege to just listen to the call and all the information you have given. And just to kind of piggyback on something you said a little bit ago about the Bible, you know, it's a wonderful thing to be on the same spiritual accord. I posted, you know, black man, you are Christ. You know, we look outside of ourselves for a savior when we really need to be looking in the mirror. I am my savior. God lives in me. I am God. We are one. God, nature, and man are one. And as long as we stay connected, you know, we can flow on that spiritual realm that we know who we are in him and we can do what he sent us here to do. And that's restore ourselves as the black man and black woman, the original creatures, humanity.
Yeah. And if we, I'm sorry, go ahead. I just wanted to support what you say. If we really, and I'm going to do a piece on this on Saturday where I'm going to be looking at the piece on Christ. If you really understand what Christ is a phenomena that takes place in every human being in every time segment, every hour, every day, every week, every month, every year. And it is a replication and an imitation of nature itself.
Absolutely.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right, sis, I'm sorry, sis, go with your question.
And I just agree. I mean, that's why we have to, like you said, you know, if you really stop and think about it and understand the Bible and its, you know, phenomenal essence, you can understand what was being said because just to piggyback on that, you know, the scripture says that 1,000 minutes is as a day, and a day is as 1,000 minutes with the Lord. You have to understand what the book is saying.
Right.
You know, and even Christ said, greater works, you know, great works have I done, but greater works will you do. But we can only do those greater works when we understand our true spiritual connection.
If we have to move the white man out of the way, take his image away.
Absolutely.
Once you move his image as God, your mind will open up to a whole new world.
It will broaden. You won't even believe the things that you begin to understand and can receive in the spirit. And this is what I received, and I heard you say this. I was talking to some friends, and the one guy is a metaphysicist and an occultist, and he was saying that he had, you know, looked into his previous lives and that in two of his previous lives he was a Asian man.
Mm-hmm.
And I think he said in another life he was a European. And it was like he was saying that, you know, we've all come back as a different, we all have been a different nationality. And as soon as he said it, it just dropped in my spirit, I'm sorry, but I've always been African. And, you know, that just didn't
but
sit well
you,
with
but
me.
You're right on it, because what our culture teaches is that you come back in the exact genetic family that you originally came here in. And they call it the Ebi, E-B-I in Yoruba. The Ebi means your lineage. And and that this lineage is formed over millions of years.
Mm.
You know, and that's why when a baby is born, they don't let the baby come out for about 8 days, and they call that outdooring. Because they're sitting around in a room with all the elders watching him or her to see who has returned.
Mm.
Who's
that's
come back?
That's a beautiful thing. And that's a good thing. I mean, like dead on, because I got a grandbaby that was born 2 years ago. And, of course, I was there when she came in the world. And when she came out, I was so mesmerized by her. And all I kept saying in my spirit was like, who are you? It's like I could identify with her. I could feel her. But I couldn't identify her, like which one of my relatives she was. But she seemed so familiar. And my daughter kept saying, Mama. Mama, Mama. And I was like, what? She's like, are you going to take pictures? But I was just gone on the familiarity of this little baby.
Because your spirit was trying to restart itself. And so even now, just spend time with her and watch her.
I do all the time.
You figure out who she is and listen to her.
Yeah,
these little ones teach us
now.
A lot.
Yeah,
I keep her with me a lot. I have her around me a lot, just talking to her, and just letting her tell me stuff. And, you know, she's all over me. When she with me, she want me to hold her all the time. And we just have a really great connection. The other thing I wanted to say before I let you guys get to a new call, the other thing I wanted to say is another thing that you pointed out was about, you know, our religion. That the funny thing, what cracks me up about it is that when you look into the Yoruba and the Orishas, the Catholic Church, who, you know, the institutors of the religions, gave us their false deities, but then they turn around and in secret they worship the Yoruba deity.
Absolutely.
Exactly. You know, like, wow, you gave us white Jesus, artificial God, Allah, you know, and I'm not knocking what everybody do because I was a sold out Christian. I was diehard. So I understand that. So I'm not knocking what anybody else does because that got me here. But as research and understanding and looking at what's really going on, you know, we have to look at the word behind the word. Spiritual, you know, within the word spirit is ritual. They have worked rituals over us. They are working spiritual wickedness in heavenly places. We find out against
us. If you go back to your history, by coming back to your history, you can design your own rituals.
Yes, sir. Mm-hmm. And that's exactly what I was saying, is that we have to look at what they've done, and because what they've done, they only learn from us. They only learn from our ancestors. They only learn from our rich culture. And that's why they traded us their false deities for our real deities. Like I said, in the secret, in the catacombs, and in the secret places of their temples, they're worshiping the Orishas, the Yoruba.
You're absolutely
deities.
Right. You're absolutely right. That's why the Black Madonnas, when the two Pope and the Pope who just left and the one came together, the first thing they did was to pray together before the Black Madonna. At the back, you know.
And but then they turned around and gave us white Mary and Jesus and replaced our
it's
Black
the hologram.
Madonna.
It's the image of the Batman up in the sky, like the little boy.
Yes,
said.
Sir. Yes,
but I know
sir.
We're running out of time, so.
Ooh, and again, I just thanks for taking my call. I consider it a pleasure, and it was been a wonderful show.
Thank
All
you
right.
so much for calling. Thank you.
Awesome. All right. Good night. Okay. Let's see, area code 770, you made it through.
Oh, my goodness. Hello, thank you. 770, it's a Georgia number, but I'm actually in Northern California now.
Where?
Thank you so much. I appreciate all I've learned from you recently. And I wanted to know just the pyramid text. What's the name of the author that I should get? I was looking on Amazon just now, and I couldn't tell which one I should get.
Oh, good. My brain is on lockdown. But there's only one real good translation of the pyramid text, and I can't recall it. But just go for it. The pyramid text, because
I saw, let's see, there's one that says Forgotten Books. By Mercer,
no,
the pyramid text.
I don't know theirs. But almost any version of it will allow you to begin to read the theology of our ancestors.
Okay.
Because
all
the white folks are doing is translating. Some of them are better translated than others. But whatever translation you can get, you'll begin to see, oh, my God, we had a theology like this thousands of years before the Bible.
Wow.
And then you will see immediately everything we know that comes from the Bible, Torah, and the Quran is already being stated in these documents.
Right.
So why are we on this other trip? We're on the other trip because we got conquered by other people who then explained the thing in their culture for themselves, and then they gave that to us, you know, once that relationship came up.
I see. Well, anyway, I appreciate you. I love, I'm going
to try
to...
What part of Northern California are you in?
I'm actually in Antioch, so I'm like 40 miles from Oakland, California.
That ain't Northern California, girl. That's Central California. I'm from Weed. You know where my chest is?
That's Northern California.
We are about 60 miles from Medford, Oregon.
Got you. But see, this is northern to me because I grew up in Southern California.
In the South,
so this
okay.
is north to me. I'm from L.A., San Diego, then got to
okay.
Oakland.
Okay,
I'm
up in the Siskiyous Mountain, the Siskiyous and Manchester. And there's a little town up there called Weed. There's four little towns, one on either side mm-hmm. of the mountain, Dunsmere,
right.
McLeod, Manchester, and Weed. Weed has mm-hmm. the largest African-American population out there ever since the 30s.
Really?
Yeah.
I'm not even familiar with that. I have not heard of it, and I'm
It's like a paradise up in those mountains. Some weekend,
mm-hmm.
just take a drive. Say, I'm going to Weed. And my big brother is Mr. Andrew Green. Just ask for him. Anybody in the county will tell you where Mr. Andrew Green lives.
I'm going to do that. That sounds fabulous. Thank you. I'm going to work on the pyramid text. I'm going to try to get you have some more online courses coming up?
Yes, ma'am. We've taken a break right now. We'll probably start back up in mid-January. I have to go to Ghana and then come back from Ghana, go to check on the hotel, because we've got to always do economic politics and culture. And about 60 of us have bought a hotel in West Africa. We've had it for 10 years. And it's a 30-room villa with swimming pool, cocktail lounge, restaurant, the whole nine. And we had problem getting the bank over there to give us a loan, so we created our own credit union, too, which is housed at the hotel.
Oh, wow.
And so, you know, trying to live what we say we are.
I know, that's right.
Be who
yes.
we are.
Well, I'm going to get started on the pyramid text. I found I found a Kindle version for $3.99. That's right
get
in
it.
My book.
Yes, get
so
it.
So I'm going to get that.
Get it.
I know that's right.
It's like a digital version, and then I'm following, you know, I started reading The Miseducation, you know, by Carter G. Woodson. I got that on Kindle, and my God, to think that he wrote that the year after my mother was born, and he
right.
was so
and it sounds
and
like
point,
yesterday.
And it matters, and it's like right now today, and I'm
right
like,
now.
Oh my God, oh
yes.
my God, this is something. So, but thank you. I appreciate
thank
all you,
you
do,
sir.
And I'm going to try to come to your villa. I'm working on all kinds of stuff, so I'll be
okay.
in touch. I'm just going to take some of your classes after the first of the year and keep it moving, trying to get my African spirituality back. Because
okay,
I know it's lost.
That's great. That's
you already
that's
got
great.
It. You're just going to grow it bigger.
Yes.
Okay.
Colin,
thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you
all
so
right.
much. Thanks, Colin.
Good evening. Thank you.
Okay, bye-bye. All right, peace. All right. Okay, let me try to just get one more. We got to get area code. Got to get area code 412-901 in here. You're on live with the Goddess Suite. Question or comment?
Oh, Brother Earl asks his permission to speak, Professor James Small.
Yes, sir.
Yes,
sir.
King Raj on the line, all right?
Yes, yes.
Hey, I want to thank the Goddess Suite for bringing one of the most beautiful, dynamic elders into our presence. This is one of our greatest scholars, you know, that we have living today. And I just want to give thanks to the ancestors right now, Dr. James Smalls. I've talked to you on the phone a couple times here and there. We talked about spirituality
and
about how we need to connect. And you just talked about it, too, as far as reaching the God within inside of you and the God inside of that woman or that man that you look for in your spiritual mate so we can bring forth these spiritual babies that will come forth and solve all of our problems that we have today. And we'll see a new, different time, you know. And I just want to say there's a lot of great things happening. I don't think we've ever been in a better place in our life than we are right now today.
No, absolutely. This is the best generation we have ever brought forth. And I'm just proud of our young people. People can say what they want to diminish them. The young people today, y'all is on it. You know, you're on it. You're transforming the world at a much more rapid pace than our generation did because it's your time, and it's your time. And may the ancestors bless you to do your work. Just do it.
Yeah.
I love it. Thank you, Brother
Earl. Questions or comments, Brother Raj?
Oh, thank y'all. I love the Goddess Week. Y'all doing a great job. Professor Smalls, sending nothing but positive energy to you, my brother.
Thank
and
you, brother.
Thank you for thanking you for helping us to be better elders as we age and get the wisdom from heaven great scholars like yourself. So thank you again, my brother.
Thank you, my brother. Peace and love to you.
Thank you. King Raj. Peace and love.
Peace and love. Thank you.
Hey, we got one more. We're gonna squeeze them on there.
Okay. Okay.
Area code 216. You are on with Brother Smalls.
Hello, Brother Smalls. How you doing?
All right, sir. Peace and love
to
you.
I'm doing good. How everyone doing over there?
We're doing wonderfully.
Thank you for calling.
Oh, yeah, no problem. I just heard somebody had hit me on to this call. Her name is Keisha, cool person. But I got several questions that I know I can't ask the several questions, so I, like, try to compact it into one. But, like, I basically, like, I've been trying to search for my spirituality because, like, I actually lost, like, my divinity, man, and, like, you know, I'm trying to find some, like, you know, like, I'm of no religion or anything like that, but I'm trying to, like, get some books to, like, search, you know what I'm saying, like, as far as, like, to find some type of divinity for myself or whatever, and I want to ask, what would be your recommendation for, like, you know, like, as far as books is concerned, like, to find my, you know, right divinity. That'll be my question.
Well, the quickest thing I could do is, like, I always believe you need to have your history first as
okay.
we're trying to fight our way out of this thing. And so I always recommend LaRon Bennett's Shaping of Black America. That's Dr. Bennett, Shaping of Black America, and Dr. Bennett, Before the Mayflower. And there's another book that I think you would enjoy and it would be helpful. It's called When We Ruled by Robin Walker, a brother from the UK. When We Rule. And what he does is a survey of thousands of years of our history, from the most ancient times to now. And then what Dr. Bennett does is deal with the African Americans piece, the Shaping of Black America Before the Mayflower. And to begin to get a sense of African traditional religion, and some people says, you know, this brother has been called before the Babalawos because he said he had a Babalawo that was he didn't really study under. I don't know from all of that, but I know Baba Ifa Karade has written a book called The Handbook of Yoruba Religion. Handbook of Yoruba Religion. You could probably find it online. And then there's another book, which is going to be harder to find, but you might find it online because he lives in Nigeria. His name is Professor Akan Jobin, AKAJOBEN, Professor Akan Jobin. And he's written a book on the Yoruba history. It's a small book, less than 200 pages, but he blows it out of the water, you know?
Mm.
And you, if you can't get that one, which is hard, get the handbook of Yoruba religion, but also read the history, because within the history, you'll begin to see how our ancestors viewed divinity. You see? That's why you got to know your history. And then when you read a book, study the bibliography. LaRon Bennett got hundreds of books you could look at in his bibliography. Robin Walker, take his bibliography, and you'll be reading for the next 50 years.
Okay, and do I got time for one more question?
No, we got somebody else on the line. Let us get other person.
Well,
but thank you, brother,
but
work on those books, and then stay in touch with the sisters. Call back in and let them know you found the book and kind of bring them up to date on the things you're learning from the books.
Yes.
Okay,
absolutely.
I definitely will. And
okay.
I thank you for your I thank you for your help, and y'all take it easy. Peace and blessings to all of y'all.
What part of the country
you
live in? Where do you live?
Oh, I live in Cleveland, Ohio.
In Cleveland?
Yeah,
yes. I was out there not too long ago, and I forgot the brother's name. You know, they do a parade this time of year. He's a police officer, beautiful brother, and he works hard. But you know what you can do, sisters? Get in touch with the sisters later, brother, and they'll give you my number, and you call me. No, I'll give it to you right now. You got a pen real quick?
No, that's what I'm trying to get. I had one, but I just got from school, so like I'm over here trying to go in the house to get a pen. But
okay, well, just call back into the show on another time, and I'm giving the sisters permission to give you my number. Call me, and I'll hook you up with some brothers in Cleveland who you can work with.
Yeah,
okay,
and contact us at the Goddess Suite on Facebook and let us know that you were speaking with the brother Small, and we'll pass on his number to you.
Okay, well, matter of fact, I'm going to add you when I get off this call. I'm going to add you Patricia Patton, right?
Yeah, Patricia Patton.
She's
on the line.
Okay.
She's listening. Okay.
So let's give a plug for Saturday night again so everybody know where we're going to be at. We're going to be at the Civil War Museum. Give the address.
Yes,
the
we're going to be
Civil
at
Civil War Museum.
Yes, the African-American Civil War Museum. The address is 1925 Vermont Avenue Northwest, Washington, D.C. Please come out, guys. We are going to have a great time.
And the time is from the time? The time?
Yes, it's from 2 p.m. to 6 p.m.
Okay.
And general admission is $30. That's for children. No, that's for adults and students with the ID. That's going to be $20. You can contact Patricia Patton at 323-929-7724, or you can hit her up at her website, www.the.connection.net. And Patricia Patton is also on Facebook, so please connect with her. Come out this Saturday, December 13th, and be blessed by Brother Small.
And we're going to awaken. We're going to show you how to awaken the God in you.
Yes. Can't wait.
I know. Well, thank you, brother, for calling.
All right. Y'all take it easy, and thank you again.
All right.
All right, have a good night. Good night.
All right, have a good night.
All right, bye. Okay, we got through everyone. All the hands that were raised, they all got, to speak.
We just want to take time out to thank Brother Small for being on the show. I mean, we learned a lot of information. I mean, and I just love the way you broke everything down with truth. You know, you made it plain for those who are just coming into this game. You just kept it real, and we love that about you, and we just can't wait to meet you on Saturday.
Okay, my dear sisters, it was an honor and a pleasure to be on the show with you. I heard about you, and so I've had fun. I wish we could do it again. So just let me know.
We would love to
come back.
Oh, gosh.
It was not enough time. It was not enough.
I know. The 2 hours went by fast. We were having fun just dealing with our divinity and our histology.
Absolutely.
Self-love is the most profound love a person can have.
And that
comes from self-knowledge. Know thyself and
know
you will learn to love thyself.
Wow.
Ashe. And I'll see y'all on Saturday.
All right.
Peace and love.
Brother Smalls.
You're welcome.
All right.
Bye-bye.
Thank you, callers. Thank you. We love you all.
All right. We've lost this show. Oh, my gosh, ladies. Wow.